is Irma tearing across the island of Anguilla. A Category 5 storm right now. Winds of 175 miles an hour.
Irma now moving in on the Turks and Caicos Islands, large portions of them at an elevation of less than 10 feet. The storm surge could be double that.
During the night of the hurricane, it was a very scary moment for me because at one point in time, I just remember thinking, what am I going to wake up to? What are we going to see when we go outside?
We looked out the window when we saw that hurricane actually hit, and it was like a train, over and over and over.
Not since Hurricane Ike in 2008 had the Turks and Caicos Islands experienced another devastating storm, as the double blow the islands received in late 2017. And the Turks and Caicos Islands was not alone. All across the Caribbean and into the southeastern states of the USA, the twin terrors, Hurricanes Irma and Maria, rolled with unwavering force, leaving many to wonder if our small islands would survive. In this three-part documentary, Turks and Caicos Islands electricity provider FortisTCI Limited shares with you how good investments, a strong disaster recovery plan, a sense of urgency and commitment to service, and robust partnerships all made a miraculous difference in the impact to the local economy and to the people of the Turks and Caicos Islands. Hurricane Irma damaged the electricity infrastructure across all islands. Many areas where power lines, poles, and transformers once stood would have to be completely rebuilt. Well over 1,200 poles were damaged or destroyed, and 79.6% of the homes and other critical buildings had suffered from Irma and Maria's wrath. It was a miracle that no lives were lost. Once signaled, the FortisSync response was immediate, and 2 days after Hurricane Irma, 58 utility workers from 7 FortisSync subsidiaries in Canada and the Cayman Islands landed on the first flight into Providenciales. Later on, another team of 60 utility workers from the U.S.-based FortisSync subsidiaries joined the team and the restoration efforts across the TCI.
We had to do a survey of the damages, so we just drove around the island and looked at the initial impact, and just looking at the amount of damage, it was evident that the fog group would be definitely common to Turks and Caicos.
Once the team got on the ground, what we did first was to do an assessment of all of the damages on the areas that we were able to see. So the first thing is to kind of get information, drive around the islands, get an initial assessment, so the teams that are coming in have a better appreciation of what they will see when they get on the ground.
So when I saw on the news, you know, the devastation that left in Barbuda and other parts of the Leeward Islands, and it was forecast to have a direct hit on Turks and Caicos, I knew it was going to be devastating.
What we were really preparing for was the worst case, that there would absolutely be no power across the island. We could be sleeping in tents. Yeah, I was happy to see once we got here that we had good accommodations, that there was power on the island, because the TCI folks did a good job of getting some of the island up before we got in here.
You know, the local crews are just phenomenal. When I went to north of Middle Caicos, which they had the least amount of damage, the team had already gotten a huge percentage of the islands of north of Middle Caicos up. Grantic was a little bit later, but the same thing was happening there. They had already started getting the prison connected, got the water plant connected, so the teams are really working. In Provo, before fog even came here, they had the underground up. The way they responded initially really helped a great deal, and I was really proud of our guys for the work that they did.
And once we got a tour of the island and got to see some of the areas that took most of the damage, it was a bit shocking to see what some of the local people here had to go through.
One of the biggest challenges with the restoration of electricity across the islands was logistics, getting materials and heavy equipment to Providenciales and then across to the other islands. Over the 60-day period, Fortis managed to coordinate the shipment of all necessary materials and supplies, including over 600 poles in the first 6 weeks, more than 60 utility trucks and scores of transformers, rolls and rolls of service wires and cables, and pallets of water and energy drinks to keep the teams going.
All of the smaller islands, it's a little different, right? They're a smaller group. The introductions were critical. You know, we ran over there, made sure did an introduction to the lead person, so they understand the details of the way fog operate.
The structure and makeup of our service territory is always a challenge, even in the best of time. Clearly in the event, the aftermath of a natural disaster, yes, an archipelago of islands of various locations within a service territory that is separated and isolated as is, does pose challenge. But the first thing you do there, even then, that's why assessing the damage, making sure your employees are safe and accounted for is so important.
Materials management played a very significant role in the restoration process, ensuring that the materials were readily available for the crew when they needed in order to expedite the restoration process.
One of the main things we rely on, not only for this hurricane, but throughout the year, is our min-max levels. And that report, we had to make sure as the hurricane approached that we had either material coming or we had material on order for what was coming. So that was one of the main things that we had to make sure we got done. One of the other things that we also had to do was make sure that our building was prepared for the storm. We also had to prepare the building for storage for other vehicles as well. So, but the main thing I think was to ensure that we had material on ground and material on order before the storm hit.
The restoration effort involved material and getting material here and understanding what we needed, what we didn't have, how were we going to get it here, how we're going to get it here in a timely fashion. Obviously, poles are critical, and we needed those initially. And then it was trucks and equipment. So we, you know, trucks were continuing to roll in, and we had to ship those over. But they needed tools. And you know, it's not like many of the restorations that I've been on where you drive your truck there, you have all your tools. Here we had guys showing up, a truck they weren't familiar with, without any tools. So not only do we have the need for people, we had the need for equipment, we had the need for material, we had the need for tools, and especially the bucket trucks. So there were a lot of challenges in this effort. This was a very large logistics effort, very large.
While getting materials, supplies, and heavy equipment to the islands was difficult for various reasons, human resources and getting qualified people who could work in strenuous conditions was another major challenge. More than 200 people worked directly on the restoration of electricity across the Turks and Caicos Islands, all doing their part to get the country back up and running.
Yeah, we had quite a big influx of foreign workers, and we had to ensure that we had the infrastructure to keep them comfortable while they work to help us. So the logistics behind the scenes, which the public is not necessarily privy to, have been a bit of a challenge.
We had to find accommodations for external crews that were coming in, as well as our local crews, because some of them had sustained damages. So we also had to ensure that our critical staff and other persons were also well taken care of.
On our first drive out here on the second day we were here, we were taken on a tour of this Millennium Highway, I believe it's called, in Blue Hills. And we couldn't believe what we were up against and what we had to do to restore the power to this area.
Well, I couldn't believe all the devastation that the hurricane caused. Pieces of roofs there and there, and vehicles beat up, and poles broke off, wire down everywhere. So we knew we had a lot of work ahead of us.
Morning starts early. 5:15 is wake-up call. Usually roll in for breakfast at 5:30, out the door at 10 to 6, meet at the office at 6:15, go through our safety moment, talk about our work for today, and then hit the ground running.
Been great. Met a few good friends now. And it was great work with the locals. People here are friendly, real friendly. Everybody's waving. A little bit used to get the donkeys walking on the side of the road. We're used to moose. So, but it's been a great experience. We learned a lot.
First of all, I want to thank Matt Wood. My wife and my three kids, and my youngest daughter, that just gave birth to my first grandchild. I wasn't there for it, but I'm sure gonna see her on Thursday when I get home.
The availability of electricity was paramount in getting the country back up and running and open for business. Within no time, flights were landing, hotels were booked, and businesses were opening their doors.
The way that the Fortis company and the corporate office reacted, I mean, it showed us that you guys were serious. You had planes coming down, so the first thing is get the airports ready. You had power to you know, get them up and running. You had people come in, and we saw them everywhere. I mean, that is very motivating. If this economy didn't get started, a lot of people would have hard times for much longer. And the fact that Fortis jumped in and really got power up so quickly is sort of an example in the Caribbean of how you can do it right.
We were able to combine really in the most optimal way resources, human and physical resources and financial resources. And we were able to put that kind of mass, I use the word firepower, on the ground, and it bore results.
I must tip my hat to the FortisTCI team. I think they have done a tremendous job. Should the recovery efforts had taken a whole lot longer, the economy in this country would have really been in a total dire straits situation.
So we were very mindful of that we did not want to miss this tourist season. So clearly that with the restoration of electricity as quick as we did, the hotels could then go about their business of restoring themselves, but also of publishing their reopening dates. And opening for business is one thing you want the country to be able to say very quickly, we are open for business.
If the utility companies, the government, the NGOs, the private sector all come together in an organized manner with passion to rebuild their country, it can happen pretty quickly. I want to say a big thank you. I have such a huge amount of gratitude. Yeah, it's great to see people come together.
I sing along, then I sing along.